out.
And welcome back to another episode of the Monster Movie Stompdown, episode 116. This is the first episode for Christmas. We're super excited about it. Got your host Sludge here, co-host across from me.
It's the Lorax.
And the Master in Texas.
Ruben.
So this one I was pretty excited for, honestly. I thought it was going to be fun. We missed Halloween just to do a lot of things. Mark in the hospital, me being sick, Ruben having to go to Georgia. Just a lot of stuff going on and put us behind. So we wanted to give you guys a Halloween Christmas. So we decided to do some werewolf films for you for Halloween and, starting this one off with Kibakichi 1 and 2, a nice double feature. Before we jump into that, gentlemen, how are you guys doing?
I'm doing good. Doing real good.
Yeah. Yeah. Almost out of the boot.
I'm hoping. I got another doctor appointment on the 13th. So hopefully you'll let me out of it.
It's just, that's what takes us so long to get down and record is waiting on Mark to get down the stairs to the studio.
Oh man, see that?
Because the boot.
who drew first blood tonight? Who drew first blood?
I had to get out there.
You went right for it.
I want to take it before we get, because we've all, you know, by the time you guys see this, Godzilla Minus One has been out for at least a week.
Yes.
We're not going to give a full review because we're going to save that for an episode. But I do want us to briefly touch on that in just a second, but we haven't yet, and I feel bad, and I just want to say thanks and welcome as the fourth person of the Monster Movie Stompdown crew. You don't see him, but he is off screen. We do have a camera guy who obviously is, you know, run the cameras now, so I don't have to, but Charles Valentine has become the fourth member of the crew, and we want to say thanks, Charles, for all that you do, since it saves me from having to do it.
Good job.
Because, I mean, I already do everything for these guys anyways. So
well, you know what that makes you? That pretty makes you, what, the life of the party?
No, it doesn't make me the life of the party. That makes you life of the party.
Life of the party, isn't it?
No. Lifetime the party.
No, I'm not the life of the party.
That's that Lifetime Network.
See, he's directing here is what this the Lorax is doing. He's trying to get somewhere that he doesn't want to go to give me a hard time about a movie that I watched with my wife, you know, but I'm man enough to admit that.
You didn't admit nothing. She sold you out, dude. She threw you under the bus.
Yes, she totally.
As soon as you watched it.
And I will say, the whole discussion, he was denying it and denying it on our little discussion on our chat. He just kept denying, nope.
And it was not necessary.
And then it got into this long conversation about what's a chick flick and what life isn't. I get complicated.
Life of the Party is a chick flick, and front and center was the Sludge watching that movie.
Melissa McCarthy.
He got caught.
What's her name?
I don't know. Don't act like you don't know that stuff now.
I don't know that.
Melissa McCarthy, I think.
The chick flick master knows. Yeah. Thank you for clearing that up, Ruben.
She's a comedian. She is a comedian. So I even question whether or not that qualified as a chick.
It has been quite the discussion. See, but what Mark doesn't want to let everybody know, the Lorax
don't tell a lie here. Now we remember this.
I was informed from Kayla, the male girl, that she watched it the same night with him in the bedroom.
Wow. I was snoring, man. I had no idea.
So I've been your son for 38 years. Yeah. No one's watching anything in the same household as you when you're snoring. Okay. It's an impossible thing to do. I know that that's false.
That's the truth.
That's just not going to happen. But, Okay. I watched a chick flick.
Yes.
Or whatever comedy. And it was quite hysterical. But, you know, the wife puts up with a lot for me. So I got to watch the movies she likes to watch every now and then. She did go watch
That was my entire point. is if you watch it with your wife, you know, she wants you to watch. You sometimes have to watch what she wants to watch. Mark, on the other hand, said he won't do it. He just said, I'm the man of the house and nobody's watching anything unless I approve it.
Yeah.
Basically.
Yeah. So, okay. So I want you listeners to let us know what you think. Is Mark really, is the Lorax the man of the house and doesn't watch what the male girl asks him to watch? I'm calling no on that one. Absolutely. And trust me, 38 years experience here. No.
Because he did state in that chat that he's never watched a chick flick.
No, that's not what I said. What I said was I never took a girl to a chick flick, dating a girl in high school. That's what you were talking about. Through high school.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. That's right.
Never happened, man. Right. Never happened.
No, but never happened. But I mean, he did buy, he did willingly watch, and he did cry in City of Angels. And I mean, that's a chick flick. You know,
I did not cry.
Oh, you cried.
What was you there
when Megan Ryan died? You confessed to crying when Meg died.
I did not confess to crying.
You cried when Meg died.
I don't like sad movies, that's for sure.
Well, but it's Meg Ryan.
I didn't.
Meg Ryan.
Yes.
Okay. I know how it, you know, that's your Phoebe Cates, and she died. And if I need to get tissues, I'll go get you some tissues. No, I know it's a hard thing for you to deal with. But
you ran out.
Yeah, he used them all the first time he watched the movie. Yeah, so when you guys listen, comment on the YouTube channel. What do you think? Does Lorax really wear the pants and never watch chick flicks?
That's right.
We're saying no here in house. So,
that's right.
But let's jump to real quick. Godzilla Minus One, man. We got to see it. I know, Ruben, you've seen it once, correct? Mark's seen it once.
An IMAX.
I am
the only way to watch it.
Yeah, that's what I've heard, man. Unfortunately, there's no IMAXs in our area to watch it on. I am a number three, and probably by the time you all see this episode, number four will have happened for me. Don't want to get into a deep review because we're going to do a full episode review on this one. Give people some more time to see the film because it apparently is being extended. But it has done some amazing things at the box office. It is the highest foreign film for Wednesday previews. In the U.S., it is the highest opening foreign film weekend gross for any film in the U.S. It's also the highest opening foreign film in 2023. So it is knocking it out of the park. I thought, just real quick, phenomenal. I will state it. It is, after three viewings, it is the best Godzilla film that's ever been made. It is the only one that stands toe-to-toe with the original and is just a little bit better. Just enough to knock 54
that's amazing.
Like, because, and 54's, man, that's a legendary. We wouldn't have anything if it wasn't for 54.
Yeah,
and that's a staple in itself. But push comes to shove, Minus One, it's better, and it's the best Godzilla film. It is, to me, the absolute new standard monster movies have to live by. It's phenomenal. Well, real quick, what did you guys think?
As soon as we got done, you know, we went and watched it, and you know, I got home, and the very next movie I watch is King of the Monsters.
The 56 2019.
2019.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, and just looking at it, and dude, I tend to have to agree with you. That tops pretty much all of them, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely.
Excellent, I mean, that was Mark holds King of the Monsters way up there. So
That was my number one. And I had to watch it again to make sure, but you know, without going into a whole lot, that's it. It is better. It's my favorite.
Yeah, Ruben, what about you, man?
The only thing that keeps 54 on the number one spot is nostalgia, and it's the original. But if I had to put them head to head, and all things equal, this one beats it. It's just phenomenal. The story, everything about it was great. Even Cindy liked it. That's how much my wife, Cindy, she went with me basically just for the popcorn, nachos, you know, whatever. I told her, I'll buy you whatever you want. You know, I just don't want to go by myself. And she said, oh, I'll go with you. She goes, I'll probably be bored anyway. Nope. She was not bored. So
that's great.
You know, she came out. She goes, that was actually pretty good. And I'm like, yeah, it was. And so, I mean, for the true Godzilla, well, not even for the novice Godzilla fan, there's just no way you come out of this movie not thinking it's just best thing that's come out from Godzilla in a, you know, Godzilla genre in a very, very, very long time. And the legendaries are great, but this is a different type of movie than the legendary.
Yeah, absolutely. It's not,
you can't, it's apples and oranges. Yes, yep. They're both Godzilla, but it's a whole different film, different type of film. So, I'd love to rave more about it, but you just, you have to go see it. I saw it in IMAX, but I'm lucky enough to have it in town, have an IMAX screen in town, but, I'd watch it on my 55 inch TV, you know, over and over again, if I could. I mean, that's how great it was. And the sounds of the movie are it's an attribute, a big attribute, if you ask me.
Yeah.
I mean, I just lost it in a couple of parts.
I agree. Me and Mark saw it, we just saw it in the standard theater the first time. The second night, there was a 4K screen at another theater playing it and actually had much better sound. And that, the first roar just shook the place. And it was just like, it's the sound is huge when it comes to this film.
The only regret I have is that I did not jump on, and I couldn't. It was during the week, and sometimes I don't know what time I get off of work. So, and they had a D-box. Wednesday's fan screening was D-box, which is the seats to move around.
I've heard that's an amazing experience.
And I've heard nothing but good things about D-box, and the gods, you know, if you watch, you know, so I didn't, by the time I went to, and thinking about it, the D-boxes were gone. They sold out. That first showing sold out almost immediately.
Oh, wow.
On Wednesday. So that's when I said, you know what, this is going to do better than people think, you know, because it was sold out. And in my theater, when I went to see it Friday night, it was full. So, you know, phenomenal movie, for everybody who listens to the show, I'm sure that if they haven't seen it, they will see it pretty soon because it's that great of a movie.
Yeah. And like Ruben said, man, like Cindy, she loved the movie. I took my wife to see it. My wife does not watch the Godzilla movies at all. And she doesn't watch foreign films either. She doesn't like doing the subtitles. She was invested in the entire film. And she was, I mean, she teared up. She laughed. You know, I mean, she was into it, you know, big time. And I remember when the movie ended and Godzilla was just so terrifying in it and so evil in the movie. I mean, when it ended, she, as soon as the credits started, she looked right at me and she's like, I hate him. I want him to burn in hell. I was like, whoa, you know what I mean? So she was really into this movie. And a cool experience when the third time I went, and then we'll move into Kibakichi here. I went with my daughter. Because we've seen every, since she's been alive, every Godzilla movie we've been able to see in theaters together we have. So I drove to Morristown, drove an hour to go watch it with her. And two of her friends came with us. And they had, neither one of them had ever seen a Godzilla film. Now, they've watched animes. They love the Studio Ghibli stuff. So they're used to going to theaters and seeing films sometimes in foreign. So they were kind of excited. But they had no idea about Godzilla. They even asked me, when we get there, I don't let them call me Mr. Reagan. I can't stand that. So they're like, Chase, is there anything we need to know? I said, well, thankfully, this is a remake of the original one. So you can come in with no information, okay? And you'll be good to go. They're like, okay, cool, awesome. They came, the movie ended, and they're like, they were just stunned. And Bella, one of Jada's friends, she's like, do you have the rest of these movies? Because I've got to watch them all now. Like, they just completely fell in love. So it was cool to see, not knocking Legendary, but to see the Toho film that it is, gain new fresh fans. Yeah. So it was super, super cool.
Yeah.
If you haven't seen it, go see it. Do what Definitely. You got to. Hopefully you have. But all right, let's jump into it, man. It is Christmas time. Now, we don't have the decorations up yet. We will have our decorations ready for you. And I'm sure the Lorax is going to pick out some awesome outfit to wear for Christmas again this year.
My glasses. The glasses still around.
They're somewhere here, man. Yeah. We keep the decorations.
I have my glasses.
But so, again, missed Halloween. So we want to give you guys a cool werewolf Christmas. And this first one, double feature of Kibakichi and Kibakichi 2. What happens when you take a spaghetti western, a yokai film, a samurai, and werewolves and mix it into a batch? I think it's awesomeness. But here you go. Here's the trailer.
A long time ago, Humans and monsters named yokai, and nature lived in perfect harmony, without interfering in each other's lives. But as time went by, humans forgot their fears. In the fourth year of Hoei 1707, the Edo government assembled a team to exterminate the yokai. The weakened yokai escaped deep into the mountains to avoid contact with the human world. Some yokai turned themselves into men, women, or the elderly to hide within the human world.
Okay, so Kibakichi 1 and 2, all right, we're kind of combine these things because they came out pretty quick. These were directed by a guy named Tomo Haraguchi, and the first one came out in 2003. The second one came out right after it in 2004. Real back-to-back deals. They do have a full manga for these films. The manga definitely gets, it's a little different, you know, like as far as some of the things that happen in the films, and it's, of course, it's a lot more expanded. But the movies were pretty simplistic. You've got Kibakichi, the main character, who is a yokai. And for those who don't know, that listen to the show, yokai is the Japanese word that's used to describe demons and monsters. And they're these otherworldly beings that live here with us in Japanese myth. And in these movies, they take place in the Edo period, Japan. So like the 14 to 1600s. And the war has broke out between the humans and the yokai, and the yokai have had to retreat to mountain villages because the humans are trying to wipe them out. And to even try and stay alive, most of the yokais transform into humans or to look like humans so that they can hide and not get persecuted or killed by the humans. Kibakichi is a samurai, lone samurai, who is a yokai that turns into a werewolf. You come to find out that he's actually from a village of werewolves that was wiped out. To his knowledge, in the first film, everyone was killed but him. We come to find out in the second movie, not so much. So Kibakichi, just a lone guy, comes up on a town of yokais, a gambling city, gambling little town, and finds out that these guys are actually luring in humans and eating humans. And there's a big whole ploy that happens, and it ends up culminating to quite the interesting climax at the in the movie, where he's having a fight. The guy who runs the yokai who runs this town partners with some humans to kind of take everything out so that they can survive. And Kibakichi's got to step up to the plate and finally turn into a werewolf and just freaking wreak havoc on everybody. Second movie follows up pretty much right after that. And he ends up going to another town, kind of befriending this blind lady and then this girl named Anju, who you come to find out Anju, who has a vendetta against Kibakichi and wants to kill Kibakichi, is one of the survivors from their town. She is another werewolf, even though he thought none were left. And she holds a vendetta on him for what happened and wants to kill him, but also doesn't want to live either. Because she believes that they should be wiped out. They shouldn't exist. Wasn't
the Anju character in the first movie also?
She was. She was introduced in the first movie, yes. Yeah. Anju was introduced in the first film, but you see her come to fruition in the second one. You do see a pretty sweet fight between Kibakichi and Anju in the second movie, but then it culminates with the big bad. I can't remember the character's name. He looks like a oversized Marlon Brando, ends up turning, and they have to team up to stop him. And it's a little more action. We'll get into that with the second one. But again, these are, don't know how to describe it other than, they're called Jigetsky films. It's a period piece film. But again, these are very much, you've got spaghetti Western in it. You've got old school samurai in it. You've got yokai tokusatsu type stuff going on. And let's find out what everybody thought.
And look at him shaking his head.
Ruben's already shaking his head off screen. Like, nah, nah, nah. So I thought this was going to be fun. I'm a big fan of the first one. Not as much a fan of the second one, but I'll get into it and I'll review it. But Mark Lorax, what did you think of these films?
First of all, this is the monster movie Stompdown.
Yes.
Okay. That was a pretty good action movie. And that's why I gave it a 3, because it was a good action. It wasn't a monster movie.
But there's tons of yokai in it.
Okay. When I would go to watch a werewolf movie, I want to see more than just this tooth before 10 minutes before the movie ends. Okay. Because basically it's all you see. And so I was so pumped up to watch this, this werewolf movie that never happened until the very end. And so I was kind of disappointed with that. Plenty of action in there. Good fight scenes, that kind of stuff. But as far as being a monster movie werewolf, I was quite disappointed.
But I mean, you got the Kappas in there. You've got the spider yokais. You've got a couple different ones in there. That wasn't enough to suffice.
Well, no. I mean,
simple enough.
Yeah, I mean, To me, pretty much the 90% of the movie that they're all humans, because they may be something else inside, but I don't see that inside. Okay, I'm not watching. I'm waiting for the things to bust loose, and they finally do about 10 minutes before the movie's over, and I think that's about you got the only other spot was where the 5 or 6 ladies turned into spiders.
Oh, I love that scene. It's a great scene.
And did their thing, but that went 2.5 minutes, and then it was over. I was just disappointed. I expected more action movie-wise. As far as action, I thought it was great. I liked the fighting in there, and I liked kind of what that storyline was about, but there's no monsters, not enough monsters.
Okay.
In my view.
That's Lorax's view on that one. Yeah. Well, Grandmaster of Texas, I can't wait to hear what this is, even though I know it's not going to be good. What did you think of, wait, man, before we get into that, Kibakichi 2. What did you think about Kibakichi 2?
Well, I thought it was difficult to watch the copy that was out there.
Right, right.
I thought it was a little bit better than the first one, actually.
Really?
Only because.
I agree.
You kind of know what's going on and going, coming into it. And so your expectation maybe a little lower than what you're anticipating from the first one. And but I did. I thought I liked the action again in it, and it to me it just seemed more knowing where the plot was going, where the movie was going. I did tend to like it a little bit better.
Okay. All right. Grandmaster, what about you?
Well, I didn't like neither one of them. And I wouldn't describe either one of them as a spaghetti Western samurai or anything else. Kung Fu theater, whatever you want to call it. All I saw was I'm with Mark. I'm like, where's the freaking werewolf? I don't see a werewolf. I see a dude with a hat and I barely see his face. That's all I see. And then they're gambling for half the movie. I'm like, what do I care about what game they're playing here and they're betting and they have special powers? I even in the chat sent a text. Is this movie about gambling or about werewolves? Because it's more about gambling than anything else, you know? And I said, yes, I understand that gambling den is run by the monsters or demons. You know, it depends on, I mean, I don't consider a werewolf a demon, but I guess whatever. So, the best part of both movies was, correct me if I'm wrong, is the Titanosaurus roar from the big bad.
That's the same effect. Yeah, there's no question about that.
I said, oh, good, Titanosaurus has kind of come out and saved the movie. Nope, did not. I did not enjoy, and I'm with Mark also, the second one was a little more watchable for me than the first one, even though Sludge here says the first one's good and the second one's bad. Well, they were both bad. But the second one was a little bit more watchable. There was a little bit more action. The big bad, at least the bad guy was a little bit, you know, you got to hear Titanosaurus again. The dialogue was very wonky. I mean, there was that he doesn't like humans because humans don't have claws.
Yeah.
What's that line? What's that line about? And then he goes, if you want to kill them, you're going to have to kill them yourself. I'm like, he just said he wanted to kill him himself. Why would you say, if you want to kill him, you're going to have to kill him yourself? Yeah, I am going to kill him myself. You know, so I thought the dialogue was wonky. Of course, that was a subtitled. Who knows what they really said? Because it was the dubbed version. I'm sorry, the dubbed version of it. So that was the hardest three hours I've had to go through in a very long time getting through those two movies.
Oh, man.
And that's because I didn't watch them back to back. I didn't watch them back to back. I watched part one, and then I said, you know what? I can't do this. I can't do this for another hour and a half or a little less than that. I can't do it. I'm just going to have to walk away from this and then maybe watch the second one the next day. And that's what I did. And but that was pretty rough. Let me put it to you in these terms. And somebody came up to me and had a copy of either one of those movies or Son of Godzilla. I pick up Son of Godzilla and watch that.
Wow. Wow.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. You
know, I'd watch Titanic. I'd watch, what was that called? This movie you just saw?
Life of the Party?
Life of the Party. I'd watch Life of the Party. I'd watch Pretty Woman. I'd watch Sleepless in Seattle. I'd watch any of them ahead of this one.
Wow. Okay.
That's rough right there.
Yeah.
And another thing on that first movie, did you think, it was dark?
It was
super dark. That's what I mean. I never saw his face. I didn't even see his tooth.
Yeah. That was another rough part, you know, to try to match what's going on because the actual screen was really, really dark.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. So. Well, so
was it the copy? Was it the copy?
It might be the copy. Like I said, that was a rip from my DVD, my personal DVD. And so it might be the copy. I don't know that it's ever been released on Blu-ray that I know of. So that could have been part of it. But that's the only way I've ever seen it.
Yeah.
Was that. So it possibly could have been because of that. To me, I thought it was just part of the way that it was shot because it's the first one's very dark and brooding as far as the atmosphere. And I'll just go with it. I mean, the first one, I love the first one. Is it the greatest? No, it's far from it. It is what it is. You know what I mean? And so I'm in the disagreement with you guys a little bit on these. The first one I thought was an absolute blast. I remember walking into a Blockbuster and it had just came out and I saw that case cover with the werewolf with the swirl face and then the samurai deal on the front, and I was like, I gotta check this out, dude. This just looks cool. And I did. I freaking loved it. You know, I loved how dark and brooding the entire atmosphere is. There's just moments in it. I mean, you know, we talked about the spider girls where they're eating people, and you know, you walk up that one. Yeah. He's, you know, that one dude's just chewing on a human head or yeah. type deal. There's just little bits of it that's just that awesome, creepy wonkiness of a yokai film. Now, I don't know if you guys have watched other yokai films like The Great Yokai War, you know, any of that stuff. Yeah. Pete would enjoy this movie. I will say that much. Pete Quint would enjoy Kibakichi. Like,
well, we know what Pete likes.
Or like Spooky Warfare.
Yeah, yeah. Wait, you say that like that's a good thing.
I think it is a good thing. I mean, he gave us Mark's favorite movie, oh, yes. Ship of Monsters, you know.
Ship of Monsters. Thank you, Pete, for that.
Yeah. But, you know, so.
Oh, I'd watch Ship of Monsters 5 times before watching
it. Oh, no. There's no way I could even do that. I like Ship of Monsters, but no.
I got to cross the line. That, you know, draw the line there, Ruben. It ain't happening.
Hey, I'm just telling you. I mean, I'd rather watch that than this.
For me, I love the first one. I love it. It was a blast when I first watched it. It's a blast for me every time I watch it. I love the creepiness on it. Well, I should say, and I totally forgot ahead of time, guys, apologize. We do like to give some warnings. There is some brief nudity in this movie when it comes to the spider ladies.
Yeah.
So just heads up.
Oh, yeah, and, I forgot you know, about that.
Yep.
Very minimal,
actually,
though.
When I was watching it the other day, the wife walked in. She's like, should this be on with the boys still running around? I looked up, and I'm like, oh, yeah, no. I was like, I'll finish this later. So just, you know, heads up on that. But I love the character, man. He doesn't say much most of the movie, man. He's super quiet. And to me, it's just like you're just waiting for him to explode at some point. And I get it, you know, when not seeing the werewolf pretty much the whole film and the first one until the very end. But to me, that was the climax. You know what I mean? You finally get to see him rip out and just do his thing because he's a freaking amazing swordsman and wipes people out, you know, through this movie anyways. I loved every bit of it. I love that the blood splatter, the cheesiness of the film. Oh. It's all over the place. And
forgot all about that. You just told me. Yeah.
Oh man,
they all have high blood pressure.
Oh, they do, man. They do. Like, I love me. You know the opening scene when he's just kind of walking and you got those bandits waiting in the grass to come out, you know, and attack him. The first thing he does is take that sword right through that dude's neck, and the blood doesn't come out. No blood comes out from the front of the neck,
yeah.
But it spews out like a fire hose all over the dude behind yeah. it. And just, I mean, that stuff just cracks me up, man. So I love the first one, man. It was action packed. I love the theme song for this movie. I really dig the theme song for Kibakichi. I love the special effects. I loved how everything looked. Loved the climax of the film. Man, when he's running around and they're just shooting at him left and right and just can't stop him, it's fantastic. The second one I didn't like as much, mainly because some of the things I enjoyed about the first one so much was lacking. The dark, brooding atmosphere. It was not as, you know what I mean, almost like dirty. You know what I mean? Like real grindhouse film dirty is how some of the scenes felt in the first one. Didn't have that as much in the second one, so I didn't, you know, I really dug that tone. And then there wasn't nowhere near as much blood in the second one. There was still great action and a lot of fighting, but I felt like their budget dropped and they just ran out of liquid blood or something. You know, I mean, it's like, where did it all go? They must have used it all up in the first film and no one had any left for the second. And then, I don't know, to me, man, like the Anju character was really cool. The idea was cool. But I almost felt like I would have rather that been the full story. Like that should have been the final fight was between him and Anju. And somehow you flesh that story out to where they do die together from that fight. Like to me, that would have been much more impactful than what we got. Not that what we got wasn't cool because you get to see them team up. You know what I mean? It's like what's more awesome than two freaking samurai or werewolf samurais going toe to toe against the big bad. To me, it was lacking. Like to me, it just felt like rushed and thrown together compared to the first one. It just lost some of the style that I liked about the first movie. It lost a lot of the blood that I liked about the first movie. And I felt the Anju Kibakichi thing almost felt like a cop out to make sure they team up at the end.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like I didn't want that. I would have rather them rip their own throats out, fighting each other and die because they're the last of their kind. You know, to me, that would have been a much better play. And that's the main reason why.
So let me ask you this, because I did, maybe I missed this. So why does she blame him for that massacre?
Because he left. He left.
Team up with the humans? Is that because he left?
Yeah, because he left.
Because they made it sound he teamed up with the humans.
Yeah. He's the one that brought the humans to their village.
Yeah.
And so I want to make sure I had that straight. Because I'm like, because even in the first one, they talk about like, well, you know, he was trying to make peace with the humans or whatever. He's the one that brought the humans to the village.
Yep. Yes. Yep.
So that's why she blames him. Okay,
blames him for everything.
Make sure I got that straight because that's how I understood it.
Yeah,
but I wasn't sure. I'm like, that was strange though. I did find that strange that they teamed up. Of course, it was like King Kong and Godzilla teamed up.
Yeah,
against Ghidorah Godzilla
to stop the big bad for sure.
It was something like that. So I mean, it made sense. That was the best part of the movie. You know, the fight scenes were the only thing that I liked. And back to what Mark said, it was more of an action movie than it was a werewolf movie, if you ask me.
Well, there's plenty of action. If anything, you get plenty of that both of these films. Yeah, so
there's some good fights going on.
So, okay, well, let's jump into it and let's find out what the Stompdown rating is and see what these guys had to say. So here we go. It's Stompdown rating time. Okay, Stompdown rating for this guy. We'll break it down, the first one and the second one. Overall, and these are really because of Ruben, overall, Kibakichi got a 2 out of 5. Me and Mark gave it a 3. Ruben gave it a big whopping 1. He likes Son of Godzilla more than these. Depending on who you listen to and what you want to see, we can recommend this movie for y'all to watch. The first one, I would say. Ruben won't probably tell you. Ruben would do that. No. Be right. You'd be like, don't watch these films.
I'm never gonna pull those movies up again.
So there you go.
That tells you right there.
That tells you. And because of my lower rating on the second one, Kibakichi 2 got a 1 out of 5 on this one because we all kind of dropped it. Well, Ruben stayed the same, 1 for both of them. But we dropped it for both of them.
Yeah,
so
I gave him 1.
Second one, we can unanimously say if you want to skip it, skip it. You don't have to pick it out. Except for Pete, you've got to watch it. But the first one,
I mean, you know, but let me disclaimer this from all three of us. I think they would agree. I mean, he's sitting right there. There's people that enjoy this type of movie. It's just not, you know. I mean, look, I'm a big Kung Fu Theater USA Network back in the day. My dad used to take me to see kung fu movies. And so it's not like I've never seen this type of movie before. It's just not my cup of tea, man. You know, it's just not. But I don't want to discourage anyone from at least giving it a shot. You know, if you could find a good clean copy somewhere. I mean, I think that's the key right there is finding a good clean copy. I might think something differently if it was in a 1080p form and maybe I could see a little more clearer or whatever. And if it was dubbed a little better, you know, that makes it that, you know, I'm knocking it for stuff that the movie itself had no control over. I don't know who dubbed it. I think there was a third grade class and they said, you know what, for a project, we're going to dub this movie.
This one, yeah.
The movie.
So that is it.
The dubbing's rough, yeah.
That's
I don't,
how they did it.
And I don't watch these dubs.
I mean, the dubbing is rough. On the second one, it was rough. And,
the second one was.
And even on the first one, it was pretty rough. So I'm gigging it on that. But if they release it on Blu-ray, I wouldn't purchase it. But I certainly would give it a shot on a streaming service to see if I feel differently about it. How about that? Is that fair enough for you guys?
That's fair enough. That works. So there you go. Yes. 2 and a 1. You know, if you get a chance to check it out, and it might be up your alley, check them out. I think especially the first one, definitely worth a watch. You know, we all at least somewhat enjoyed the first one. Second one, if you like the first one, give the second one a shot, and you can make a your own determination, what you decide you want to do. So, all right.
Me and Mark enjoyed the second one better, a little bit.
Well, yeah. Mark enjoyed it more, so I enjoyed it less. So everyone's each their own. So watch the first one. If you like it, find the second one and give it a shot. And you might enjoy some awesome, well, I think it's awesome, samurai werewolf, spaghetti Western action. So that was pretty good. But all right. So it is now back to that time of the episode that you all like. It is time to test your might.
Test your might. Test your might. Test your might. Test your might. Test your might.
All right, and again, thanks to the awesome Kurt Harper, we have got trivia. Kurt, again, thank you so much for stepping in and being our trivia master as of late. We greatly appreciate it. And this one, I'm kind of worried about, not going to lie. I don't know how much he's dug, because outside of just being a normal viewer of these movies, I don't know that I know too much about him. You know what I mean? As far as behind the scenes.
This could be interesting.
Like I do the other movies. So we shall see how it goes.
I will say there was not much out there. Trivia, what I would think would be trivia. There was not much out there that I could think of. So,
well, then we'll see. I did a little bit
of digging, but not much. There was not much out there.
So, how are we doing this? How many questions?
Let's see. He has three and a bonus.
Three and a bonus.
All right.
Gamera.
Kurt says trivia
is Gamera, friend of all children.
Wow, yes. We'll get there and find out. So, all right. Kurt does say trivia is getting hairy. Hopefully you fellas can trim the wrong answers. I love Kurt's openings of these trivias. Thank you, Kurt. Number one, wolves, in parentheses, Canis lupus hodophilax and Canis lupus hetale, went extinct in Japan. How do you make a werewolf extinct in Japan? A, has to be a silver bullet to the heart, just like a regular werewolf. B, it's regular yokai, however you usually kill a yokai. Or C, decapitation with a sword blessed by a Shinto priest. Do I need to repeat any of those, fellas?
No.
I'm going to go with what I think is an obvious here. All right. Number two. Yeah. Kibakichi is based on a manga. What is this manga called? A, Homeless Wolfman Kibakichi. B, Ronin Wolf Warrior Kibakichi. Or C, Wolfman Yokai Kibakichi.
I know this one. Hey, all right.
Do that. I don't.
Do that one. So, all right. Number three. Don't even repeat anything there, right?
No.
Number three. Blood is pretty colorful in Japan, and even the smallest cuts result in arterial sprays. What color is the blood of the three wicked yokai in part two? So this is Kibakichi 2. What color is the blood of the three wicked yokai in part 2? A, awful pus yellow.
Yeah.
B, sickly rotten green. I'm sorry. Yeah, B, sickly rotten green. Or C, a lovely shade of blue.
I remember this.
Same here.
I don't.
I might not be as bad off because of two of these questions. All right, ready for the bonus question.
I'm ready.
If Godzilla fought a giant albino werewolf, I like this. Who would win? A, Godzilla. Oh, come on. Godzilla has no love of children. B, Godzilla. Or C, not us because they didn't finish the movie.
Oh, that's tough. I mean,
what? I know what he's talking about here. Ruben, you know what he's talking about?
I don't know what he's talking about.
Oh, we're going to just have to answer this one. But see, this could be one of two questions here.
Okay, so.
Yeah, it may be one of two answers. You're right, but I'm going to go with the one that's kind of obvious.
Oh, but see, one of them's, I mean, I'm going to go for it. I'm going to be fair because it could be one of two, two and two. So, all right, real quick before we get to the answers. The albino werewolf mark. One of the special effects guys that worked on King Kong versus Godzilla and some other films started filming his own independent Godzilla movie called Godzilla versus the Wolfman. And he fought a giant white albino werewolf in it. But unfortunately, he never got to finish the film. There's been, 11 minutes of it put together, I think, something like that, Ruben?
Yeah,
something like that. And a couple years ago at G-Fest, he compiled all of the complete footage, including the fight between the werewolf and Godzilla, and showed it at G-Fest. So that's where he's getting it from. Actually, it's on the Plex. All of it's in its entirety of what's available is on the Plex.
Well, I missed that one.
So, all right, here we go. Oh, and ready for answers? Number one.
Yep.
Wolves went extinct in Japan. How do you make a werewolf extinct in Japan? Correct answer was B. It's a regular yokai, so however you usually kill a yokai. Yes. Two. Kibakichi is based on a manga. What is this manga called? It is A. Homeless Wolfman Kibakichi. Did you get that one right?
Nope.
Oh, sorry. I thought. I did.
I knew. I read that somewhere.
Oh, well, I was like, we talked about the manga, but I was like, oh no, wait, I didn't tell the name of the manga. My bad. Three.
You did talk about the manga,
but I did not give the name away. Number three. Blood is pretty colorful.
I just didn't think it'd be that cheesy.
He is homeless. He's always trying to find a place to stay. I mean, think about it. You know, just the worst places. Number three, blood is pretty colorful in Japan, and even the smallest cuts result in arterial sprays. What color is the blood of the three wicked yokai in part two? It is C, a lovely shade of blue.
Oh, I thought it was green.
Mm-hmm. It's cowboy blue.
Cowboy?
I don't remember. I remember.
It was kind of hard seeing any color of blood.
It was difficult in copy. Sorry.
I was trying to watch.
Tried to find the best we could.
Yeah.
All right, and the bonus, if Godzilla fought a giant albino werewolf, who would win? He put B, Godzilla. Duh, I got that one wrong.
I got that one right.
I picked...
I got it wrong. I put the albino...
Yes, thank you
too.
Very much.
I put C, too. Not us, because they didn't finish the movie.
Yeah, I tried to tell you guys.
That's what I thought.
You guys think you know everything.
That's not fair.
Well, I got 3 out of 4.
Well, that stinks.
I got 3 out of 4.
Oh.
I got 3 out of 4.
Mark, I'm sorry. He picked the last one. So
Planet of the Dinosaurs. Let me tell you about that.
Planet of the Dinosaurs.
Yeah, that's right.
This last
one. It's on your son.
I got 2 out of 4.
It's not on me today.
So,
Mark got 2 of them. Okay, right on.
But go right ahead.
Well, no, Planet of the Dinosaurs.
Planet of the Dinosaurs, man, was great. Love it. You know, the claymation, I thought was very good.
It is.
Very, very good. The whole, you know, the plot's kind of okay. You know, a spaceship crashes on a planet and has this filled with dinosaurs, and they're just trying to survive and get through it. And overall, I enjoyed it. Thumbs up, man.
Oh, I think it's fantastic. I love that movie.
I appreciate it. I do.
So which ones did you enjoy more? The ones that he just forced us to watch, or my penalty movie?
I'll take the Planet of the Dinosaurs any day.
any day, he says.
You wanna punish me? Make me watch these two over again.
Instead. So
and I'm gonna say it again with these two. I don't think I'm ever gonna pick a bad movie, because every time I think there's one, even some that Pete recommended me to, you guys are like, oh great, I'm gonna watch this movie. I'm like, oh, I can't win with Pete's suggestions. How am I ever gonna win? I don't get it.
Oh well, I am going to, since Ruben picked the last one, Mark, I may try and go a little easy on you here.
Okay.
And mainly because I just see it across from us because one of the cameras is sitting on it. But have you ever seen the Crater Lake Monster?
I have. I think I saw it with you.
Yes, you have.
I'll watch it again, sir.
Actually, no, I take it back. So you get to watch Creature from Black Lake.
Okay.
Yeah. Bigfoot.
I don't know that I've watched it.
Bigfoot monster movie. Actually, if you'll pull it out from the shelf over there, show it to the camera. If our cameraman will put up a good zoom on your on your camera. Pull it out right there. That is the original VHS release of that movie.
Yeah.
And I paid a whopping $56 for that. Before it came out on DVD, somebody, for whatever reason, because I'm going to say for whatever reason, decided to put it on DVD. Before it didn't exist, it was very expensive to get on VHS because it was hard to come by. And all of the money and special effects is put into one scene that is quite mind-blowing. So I'd be interested to see what you think about this for the Bigfoot monster
comes with
films.
Starring Jack Elam. I was always been a Jack Elam fan.
That one will be interesting. Cool. So. We will find out the next one, what you thought about the Creature from Black Lake.
I bet there's more footage from the Creature of the Black Lake than there was of the werewolf in these movies we just watched.
Well, you're not wrong.
I'm positive.
You're not wrong. Maybe by like 30 seconds, but you're still not wrong. Okay. So, all right, man. There we go. So Mark's going to let us know about that on our Christmas special episode, which what we've picked out for you, since, again, we are doing a Halloween combo here since we missed out on with you guys. We're going to continue with the Werewolf Christmas, and this year, a new movie, since last year we did The Mean One, which is a ripoff of The Grinch, that I still absolutely love that movie. We are going to do a Werewolf Christmas movie, yep. And just so happens, this year came out Werewolf Santa. What happens when Santa gets bit by a werewolf and becomes one himself? You'll just have to see on the next episode.
Oh, yeah.
And if you want to, watch it before so that you can come watching it with us and see what you thought. You can rent Werewolf Santa on Vudu, YouTube, and Google as well. So to check it out your all selves if you want to, because it is a brand new movie. And pretty excited. That one should be fun. I have no idea if it's going to be any good. We've seen the trailer. Looks ridiculous.
We'll know if it's any good, because you are the life of the party.
Oh, my gosh. I am the life of the party.
We do appreciate that.
Thank you, Melissa. McCarthy. Melissa McCarthy. Even our cameraman's like, McCarthy, dude. Yeah. Get it right.
Right.
I'm sorry, man. I just couldn't keep up with it. So, all right, man. Thank you guys again so much for watching and listening to the shows. We definitely do. Make sure, join us on the Facebook groups. Follow us on Instagram. We try to give you guys some extra content throughout the week. I know things have been a little rough as far as me keeping some things caught up, but we will get that corrected. But again, we love to discuss. Man, there's been so much discussion of Godzilla Minus One on the groups lately. It's been a blast. Not just that, but the Monarch shows, the new Godzilla and Kong trailer. It's a family unit, man. Oh, yeah. We all hang out. Yep. And, obviously, Kurt Harper, he was just a listener, and now he started doing the hard copies and moved from that to now he's doing questions. And we do plan on doing a Godzilla Minus One review, full episode. We've got another listener friend who wants to jump in on that. So, it's great. It's what it's about. So join us on there and become part of the crew.
We should consider Monarch too, doing the Monarch series.
When Monarch finishes, we will be definitely doing that for our TV episodes. But again, we appreciate it so much. And, of course, stay tuned for the Christmas episode where we're going to do Werewolf Santa. And again, check out our buddies at the Give Me Back series. Give Me Back My Action Movie. Give Me Back My Horror Movies. Give Me Back My Pro Wrestling. Pete and his crew at Good Beer Bad Movie Night. We recommend all of those shows. And appreciate you again for listening. Stay tuned for the next one. This is Sludge.
And Lorax.
And you got Ruben in Texas.
Y'all have a good night.
Good night.